Itself and as historians, as crafts people. Javier's first book, Carlo Ginzburg, the Historian as Theoretician, 1995, was an epistemological discussion of the historian's craft, focusing on Carlo Ginzburg's work. His second book, Dangerous Speech, A Social History of Blasphemy in Colonial Mexico, 2006, analyzes the representation, prosecution, and punishment of blasphemous speech in New Spain from 1520 to 1700. Javier is also the author of numerous articles and book chapters, and in 2009 he received an NEH fellowship for his research. Javier's project this year at the Institute is entitled Perjurers, Impersonators, and Liars, Public Faith and the Dark Side of Trust in 18th Century Mexico. And in this project, he continues to explore performance and representation in the context of an emerging public trust and the relation between the state and its subjects or citizens. Today he's going to speak on reframing gambling, Bourbon morality, public trust, and the royal lottery in colonial Mexico.
Thank you for coming and taking the time this afternoon to be with me. The project, the paper I'm going to present is part of a larger book that I'm trying to write about the history of trust in 18th century Mexico as it related to the ideals of modernity of the Bourbon reformist. Let me start. On the morning of August 7th, 1770, colonial authorities posted a royal decree in the main streets of Mexico City that described the social and moral dangers of games of chance in decisively somber tones. According to this document that I want to read to you, the inhabitants' passion of gambling was responsible for the impoverishment of a considerable number of families and the moral dissolution of the colony. It is because of gambling, one could read in this document, that marriages are dissolved, women become prostitutes, and men indulge in idle practices that are not useful to the state. The decree indicated that this horrible situation provoked an immense pain to the king and an ardent desire to extinguish a disorder that corrupted the majority of his beloved subjects. In spite of these dramatic and emotional overtones, the Bourbons' condemnation of gambling as a source of vice, laziness, poverty, and as an obstacle to the development of productive working subjects was hardly news to the inhabitants of the colony. Authorities had long emphasized the dangers of gambling in a number of decrees and other pieces of legislation. What was new, perhaps, and surprising to the inhabitants of New Spain was the king's solution to the problems associated with the passion for gambling, more gambling. What Charles III had in mind was the creation of a lottery as an attractive substitute for the illegal games, the so-called juegos prohibidos, or prohibited games, mostly just card games and dice. And as an additional, he was also looking for an additional source of income for the crown. In an effort to promote the new game, Viceroy Marquez de Croix insisted in August 1770 that the lottery was a moderate and innocuous form of entertainment that benefited society without truly deteriorating the gambler's fortune. Quote, those of great fortune, if they play with moderation, not only won't risk their wealth because of the lottery, but could also increase it, while those of lesser means will not get poorer, but happier, unquote. Given the fact that the vast majority of lottery gamblers lost their bets, as it is normally the case in lotteries, it remains to be seen how becoming perennial losers could make people happier. It is, of course, possible that gamblers saw lottery tickets as an investment, not as an investment, but as a sort of passport to a short but exciting real-life drama. This would imply that the happiness allegedly triggered by the lottery would be prompted by the state's successful framing of the game as a sort of money-for-nothing affair, or almost nothing, where everybody was to gain. The crown would get more resources. Public order would be guaranteed by repressing, supplanting, or suppressing or competing with illegal gambling, and people would be entertained. Now, this image which has been unfortunately endorsed by most of historians of the lottery, is misleading on a number of accounts. As scholars of state-sponsored gambling have long argued, lotteries are nothing but a form of regressive taxation that makes possible the voluntary transfer of funds from the gamblers to the state and the lucky few. More concerning still is the fact that people of the lower classes tend to spend a higher percentage of their income in lottery tickets than the better off. This was certainly the case in colonial Mexico. The initial project proposed to the king by Francisco Javier de Sarria planned the creation of state lotteries, but only one of them, two state lotteries, but only one of them, the so-called Lotería General, was approved. This lottery consisted of 50,000 tickets sold at 20 pesos each, and after discounting the 14% of the amount collected for the king, about 800,000 pesos were to be distributed in 5,000 prizes that range from 50,000 to 30 pesos. Unfortunately, the calculations of Sarria were completely wrong. People refused to pay 20 pesos for a ticket, and the lottery never collected more than 90,000 pesos per drawing. The first drawing was scheduled to take place on January the 2nd, 1771, but because of a small number of tickets had been sold, it had to be postponed until May. The viceroy then decided to reduce the ticket price to 4 pesos and ordered the fragmentation of the key tickets into fractions of 1 peso. Although this was still a lot of money for the majority of urban workers, this is a time in which an unskilled urban worker made 6 pesos per month, the lottery did well. It was only after making the tickets accessible to the poor that the lottery started to grow steadily in popularity, as reflected in the chart that you have in your handouts, the first chart. I don't have it projected, so this is the reason I put together the handouts. As you can see, the lottery is doing really well until 1810 or so. And this is something that I will discuss later in the paper. So it's until 1810 that the lottery started to decline. So the lottery never yielded revenues comparable to those of tobacco. Powder, salt, and playing cards, but it consistently outperformed the monopoly of the Juegos de Gallos or the cockfights. These are monopolies that the Crown had, and this was the closest competitor. The profits were not negligible indeed, especially after the King decided to increase his share of the annual funds collected to 16% in 1781. Together, we're talking about $16 million for the whole period. It is difficult not to be surprised by the success of the lottery among the popular classes. For the late colonial period, it was characterized by price increases, wage stagnation, and the multiplication of taxes, all of which, of course, enlarged the gap between the rich and the poor. There's a famous article by Eric Bagnon that claims that the richer got richer, the poorer got poorer. That's the title of the piece. Most of the tickets were sold in Mexico City and other urban settings where poor people clearly struggled to make ends meet. According to the economic historian Carlos Marichal, Mexican urban worker families paid between 8% and 15% of their income in direct taxes to get their basic staple needs. It did not help at the time that the price of the most basic staples, such as maize, increased steadily, while salaries of the rural and urban workers remain generally stable. Bad times cause desperation, and it is possible that the poor turn to lotteries in an attempt to escape hardship, a decision that could only lower their living standards. But how did the Spanish crown succeed in selling this new product to its subjects? What role did the staging, display, and promotion of specific emotions play in lottery propaganda in Bourbon, Mexico? In my presentation today, I will seek to answer these questions through a study of the complex palette, emotional palette, that accompanied the emergence of lottery consumption in Spain. In particular, I will discuss the impact of anticipatory emotions, that is, emotions driven by uncertainty about the future in the player's decision to gamble. When individuals face situations of anticipated risk, they can either experience positive feelings, and here I'm quoting literature by psychologists and philosophers, they can either experience positive feelings such as hopefulness, excitement, and suspense, or so-called negative emotions such as anxiety, or a combination of both categories. In the case of the Mexican lottery, popular anxiety and fear over job losses, price increases, and stagnant wages lurk in the background as players acquire tickets with the hope of improving their lot. The Royal Lottery's selling point, however, was not only the possibility of enrichment, but also the excitement and suspense to be experienced while waiting for the drawing results. In contrast to other forms of gambling, lottery participation entails a waiting period that heightens the feelings of excitement, of hope, and most importantly, suspense. Using engravings, rituals, stories, and other forms of propaganda, Bourbon officers marketed the lottery not only as an exciting product, but as a source of excitement, hope, and suspense in itself. Royal lottery officers understood well that selling consuming experiences is more important than selling products. Such experiences were only possible when people trusted in the authenticity of lottery tickets and in the integrity of sellers and administrators. Unfortunately, such expectations were not always met. Like other anticipatory emotions, trust is an affective projection into the future. Yet its main purpose is to overcome uncertainty, not to relish in it or to enhance it in any way. Uncertainty about the future can trigger enjoyable emotions, of course, but as you'll be seeing, it can have devastating consequences when trying to sell a product. Although I claim that emotions can indeed account for the negative and positive incentives to lottery consumption, my analysis departs from the tendency to see consumers' needs and desires as merely manufactured from above. Lottery officers did not instill in their patrons the desire to gamble, but they did have an impact on their motivations to play by endowing the act of gambling with new meanings. In Bourbon, Mexico, the successful marketing of the Royal Lottery implied redefining gambling as a form of leisure and charity. I hope to show that such redefinition was made possible because the Spanish Crown explored the historical opposition of the population to the population's indulgence in playing juegos prohibidos to legitimate the lottery as a privileged tool to prevent, regulate, and control illegal gambling. The lottery was, in this sense, a tool of late colonial governmentality. Its creation and promotion gave way to a set of wonderful contradictions that I hope to disentangle in the last minutes of the presentation. So, first point, gambling as leisure. Moralists and Christian writers have long decried gambling as a passion that is an unbridled, overpowering, and insatiable form of appetite, of desire, that took control over the human soul and easily led gamblers into fraud, theft, cheating, and in all life spent in bad company and blasphemy. By the 18th century, however, popular gambling came more and more to be considered as a secular danger, a ludic practice that led to the financial ruin of all the participants and their families and the corrosion of social order and hierarchy. Gambling was now condemned because it constituted a source of vice, laziness, poverty, and an obstacle to the development of productive subjects. It is in this context that the Spanish king justified the creation of a lottery as a form of forestalling the social dangers of participating in illicit games and as a means, as I said before, of fostering the happiness of the subjects. Of course, such happiness was premised on paternalistic assumptions that proclaimed to give the subjects what they needed, not necessarily what they wanted. As a form of gambling, lottery has been around in Europe and the Americas for a long time. The first lotteries in Europe probably originated as a form of amusement in games, in festivals and parties, but the state decided to sponsor lotteries as a form of profit as early as the 16th century. By the 18th century, lotteries were held in most of the European countries, but it was not until 1763 that the Spanish Crown finally established a lottery in Madrid. In the Americas, the first lottery was created after the tsunami, the horrible tsunami that took place in Peru. That is in, the tsunami was in 1746 and the lottery was in 1766, was established in 1766. The one in Mexico, it was in 1769, And by 1778, we have lotteries also in Chile and in Peru. At this time, the official one. In establishing a lottery, the Spanish crown not only had the happiness of its subjects in mind, as in modern times, Bourbon ministers argued the lotteries were an excellent way of raising revenues without raising taxes. In their opinion, lotteries were more acceptable and popular than taxes because the participation was voluntary. But lottery tickets are not necessities, and it took a great deal of propaganda from colonial authorities before the lottery started to yield some profits. It is hardly surprising that the lottery didn't do well at the beginning. As I mentioned before, the tickets were too expensive. The means to promote the lottery were also precarious at best. There were decreased word of mouth information. But lottery bureaucrats advertised the game as a fun and exciting road to riches by emphasizing the amount of the prizes without informing the population about the odds they had to beat to win the prizes. By taking away the real onus of gambling, colonial authorities hoped to nourish the fantasy of turning one's life around that motivated working people to buy their next ticket. It is also possible that the circulation of stories of successful players over time, either real or invented, contributed to the growing interest in the game. Similarly important for the promotion of the game was the circulation of almanacs, algebraic tables, and cabalistic literature of all sorts that promised to reveal the secrets of the lottery. Much of this literature was either allowed or even printed by the Spanish crown itself. The population was also enticed to play the lottery through a series of engravings depicting characters explicitly created to advertise the game, such as the lottery fanatic, el jugador afortunado, el fanatic por la lotería, and the fortunate player, el jugador afortunado. These engravings were widely reproduced as a sort of and especially, I'm sorry, the lucky dwarf. Let me show you the lucky dwarf. This is very interesting. This engraving was reproduced many times. It became quite popular. It has numbers. The whole body is made of numbers. And it became a symbol of the lottery. These days in Spain, you can still find lottery distribution centers that they are called El Enano Fortunado. There, it is that popular. So colonial authorities, of course, my analysis of these engravings is it's not complete, so I'd be interested in learning what you think about the engravings themselves. Why precisely a dwarf? Why not a normal human being? I mean, a tall human being. I'm sorry for all of that. Colonial authorities also used to press to keep the lottery in people's minds. For instance, the Gaceta de Mexico informed its readers about the dates of lottery drawings and the winning tickets among a plethora of equally entertaining news that included religious celebrations, festivals, funerals, earthquakes, hurricanes, miraculous healings, monsters, and scientific wonders of all kinds. It is in this context that the lottery drawing the results were given to the population. Given the colonies' low levels of literacy, however, it is likely that the most dramatic means of propaganda were the lottery drawings themselves. According to the Plan y Reglas para el Estamento de la Lotería, that is the reglament, the rules to put together the lottery, the drawings were to take place in the presence of judge, conservator of the lottery, the director, the accountant, the chief clerk, and the scribe. A few days before the drawing, the numbers and the corresponding prizes were placed into two rotating wooden barrels, one for each category, and secure with a key. The barrels were later deposited in a safe with three locks, the different keys to which were kept by the judge conservator, the regidor, and the accountant. The drawings were performed in all solemnity following a careful scripted ritual. After rotating the two wooden barrels with the numbers and the corresponding prizes for 5 minutes, the chief clerk opened the doors to the barrels, and two young boys were chosen to pull out the tickets and the prize slip simultaneously. The numbers and prizes were read aloud by the boys and were later repeated 3 times by an announcer. As in other early modern lotteries, there were blasts of trumpets and rings of bells that followed the announcement of the winners and their prizes to draw people's attention. Once 10 extractions had been completed, the barrels were put in movement for one more minute, and a second round of 10 selections took place. These were repeated over and over for 12 days until all the prizes were awarded. A list of winners was posted every day after daily extractions, and the list of winners was finally distributed at the end of the 12 days, and was posted in the main streets. The lottery rituals were clearly set out to steer and impress the audience by an apt manipulation of suspense. Baroque artists, pedagogues, and politicians had long explored the advantages of inducing a state of anxious instability in their audiences by bringing the forces of contemplation and admiration to a halt, only to unleash them later with greater effectiveness. Philosopher Luis Alfonso de Carvalho counseled dramatic authors in the 17th century to have the listeners' psyches in suspense, now happy, now sad, now amazed, and with a desire to know what will happen in the end, because the greater the suspense and desire, the more agreeable after the end, end quote. The correlation of suspense and emotional excess that characterized the lottery was well illustrated in a series of woodcuts and engravings known as Alleluias that described the expressions of joy, elation, and despair of players on lottery day. Initially designed to serve religious purposes, such as recounting the lives of saints, the Alleluias got their name from the practice of distributing them in mass when the priest said Alleluia. These popular broadsides were often accompanied by captions and soon expanded their subject matter to folklore, plays, moral tales, humor, and even political commentary and educational material. The images were widely distributed in Spain and probably made their way to the Americas to promote the lottery not only as an exciting game, but as a source of excitement. Let me show you there. Of special interest is the engraving titled Expresión de Jugadores, El Día de Lotería, Expressions of Players on Lottery Day, which was apparently based on a popular sainete, a short play or a farce by Sebastián Vázquez entitled Día de Lotería. The play, which was staged in Madrid in 1777 and in Mexico in 1792 to great success, depicted the rich palette of emotions endured by players on Lottery Day. In the main plot line, a young couple buys a lottery ticket following the expert advice of an unidentified estudiante. So, scholar. The husband leaves the house to find out the drawing's results and promises to come back on a litter, a luxury befitting only the newly rich. Unfortunately, the husband not only did not win the lottery, but also broke his leg in an accident. So, seeing her husband approaching on a litter, the young wife throws the old furniture and houseware with great enthusiasm through the window. And the husband cries in despair, "What are you doing? My leg is broken. Stop, wicked woman, we did not win the lottery." By the late 18th century, the lottery was a well-established, as a form of leisure and a source of extreme emotions in colonial Mexico, that Franciscan Joaquín de Bolaños deemed it appropriate to compare Judgment Day itself to the lottery day to convey the mixture of amazement, awe, and fear with which the faithful would wait to learn their fate in their creator's lips. Now, my second point, public welfare, gambling as charity. As in contemporary lottery bureaucracies, colonial authorities tried to expand the sale of tickets by appealing to the goodwill of the gamblers. There was no indication in the normativity of the lottery about how the collected funds would be used. But the Viceroy Carlos Francisco de Croix reminded the population that lotteries had been used in the past to raise funds for buildings or expand churches or erect schools or finance orphanages. Years later, in 1781, Viceroy Martin de Mayorga granted a concession of 2% of the lottery earnings to the poorhouse after the director of the asylum threatened its closure because of bankruptcy. The state's tactic of earmarking part of its profits for popular causes even succeeded in winning over the church. Moralists and Christian writers had long opposed lottery gambling as a form of usury, but religious authorities fully embraced the new game when they saw the profits. To be sure, raffles have been organized in the past to build or expand religious buildings such as several. But in 1782, there was a big number of small lotteries organized by convents, schools, or orphanages. In 1786, the church had a large lottery known as Nuestra Señora de Guadalupe that apparently was also very popular. But the state narrowly relied on moral sensibilities and the promise of instant gratification to foster lottery playing. Colonial authorities also made sure to reduce dramatically the gambling options available by raiding gaming dens, imposing fines, and prosecuting those who played the so-called prohibited games. Again, these are dice and cards. Paradoxically, the removal of religious taboos against lottery gambling brought about new competition to the state. In 1784, Viceroy Bernardo de Galvez prohibited the creation of other illegal lotteries and raffles. A year before, Charles III had emphasized the royal lottery monopolistic aspirations by prohibiting the introduction to the colonies of tickets of foreign lotteries. He followed this decree with another one issued in 1788, forbidding the creation of competing raffles. For their part, lottery employees were expected to prosecute organizers of small lotteries and raffles as well as illegal gamblers. Paradoxically, the king undermined his own policy by approving in 1790 the creation of a new lottery called auxiliaries to fund public works. My third point, the problem of trust and accountability. The redefinition of gambling as leisure and charity and the reduction of alternative options to gamblers provided the ethical and the normative trappings to sell the game. More challenging, however, was the task of securing and keeping the trust of lottery consumers. Research on consumerism has long shown that the emotional attachment of patrons to specific products is rarely constant. Excitement over a new product often fades as familiarity sets in, and pleasure can easily morph into boredom over time. Products can indeed lose their emotional appeal, but it is an entirely different matter when consumption of a specific good declines because of consumers' lack of trust in the quality of the commodities or the integrity of the producers and sellers. As a form of emotional commitment to the other, trust implies a positive feeling of expectation regarding another's future actions. But bridging the present and the future, trust brings a sense of certainty to social action. However, because trust implies an affective acceptance of dependence, failure to meet the expectations of the trust giver can be devastating. In colonial Mexico, lottery tickets were sold on a set of assumptions as to the genuineness and authenticity of the tickets and the good faith and rectitude of retailers and administrators. Unfortunately, colonial authorities had to deal from the very beginning with cases of forgery, falsification, and fraud perpetrated by conmen, certainly, but more surprisingly, by lottery officers themselves. Lottery tickets were considered documents issued by the king himself. This implied that forgers were liable to the same harsh punishment reserved for other crimes of lese majesté, such as money counterfeiting. To prevent falsification, tickets were sealed with a royal imprint kept in a small box of three keys. The director, the accountant, and the notary held each one of the keys. The notary was in charge of selling the tickets and collecting the signature of the director. Tickets were then distributed to the colecturias of several important cities. Lost tickets were duplicated and sealed twice with a small sello real, sello de contramarca, a small seal, thus annulling the lost original. For their part, lottery sellers were expected to keep three books where they registered the tickets sold and the date of the sale, the assets and liabilities, and the official correspondence related to the lottery. The money collected was kept in a box of three keys held by the director, the accountant, and a juez conservador. Tickets not sold were collected and taken to the direction. In spite of the harsh legislation and security measures taken against the falsification of tickets, forgery of these documents was apparently common. In 1771, Don Joaquim Armijo, a Spanish inhabitant of Puebla, altered the number of his lottery ticket to claim a price of 125 pesos using his skills as a silversmith. His attorney claimed that Armijo had not really forged a ticket, but merely altered an original, a transgression that deserved a milder punishment. The judgment was, of course, unmoved. Armijo was forced to return the money and sentenced to serve 3 years in prison island of Sahan de Ulua and to pay the cost of the trial. A similar argument was advanced more than 20 years later by the attorney of Don Juan Miguel de Jasso y Otal. In 1790, Jasso y Otal stole 88 tickets for lottery 238. After forging in quotation marks, the seal of the Royal Lottery and the signature of Sarria, he actually came up with a signature and a seal. Jasso succeeded in stealing only 6 tickets before getting caught. His attorney argued that Jasso's crime consisted of stealing 88 tickets, not of forging them, for he did not even try to imitate Sarria's signature and the lottery seal. In the prosecutor's view, this trivial argumentation was nothing but hair splitting. Accordingly, Jasso was sentenced to serve 10 years in a garrison, or 12 in the King's Army. A more concerning breach of public trust took place, however, when lottery officers abused their position to enrich themselves. 10 years before Jasso y Otal was caught in 1780, the director of the lottery himself, along with his accountant and the lottery seller of Mexico City, were charged with embezzling about 26,000 pesos. Although the director could not be proven guilty, he became suspicious when it was learned that he owned haciendas in Chalco and Chamanalco, while his accountant had somehow managed to buy one for himself in Texcoco. Sarria was deposed temporarily, and the king enacted a set of reforms to increase the oversight and regulation of the lottery. Such reforms were clean and sufficient, for in 1803, a new fraud rocked again the lottery buyer's confidence. This time, the ones indicted on corruption were the director, Luis Noalles, and his treasurer, Don Juan López Guardalmuro. Working in collusion with the official printer of the Royal Lottery, Don José María Ogal, the officers duplicated lottery tickets for unclaimed lottery prizes and pocketed the money. While the director was removed from the office, the Crown rescinded the lottery privileges from the printer Ogal. Fearing for the reputation of the lottery, colonial authorities tried to hide the crime from the public, but they were not successful. The new fraud brought about a decrease in lottery gambling and prompted authorities to suspend the lottery temporarily. Starting in 1810, the Royal Lottery entered a period of steady decline as mass insurgency, political uncertainty, and economic dislocation brought about a sharp decrease of the funds collected, and trust in the survival of the colonial state itself started to crumble. In 1812, colonial authorities tried to rekindle interest in the game by creating an additional lottery that did not do well. 3 years later, Viceroy Calleja tried a different approach by instituting 2 complementary lotteries, one for Mexico City and the other one for the rest of the country. The proceeds were to supplement other emergency funds of the forms of taxation, such as forced direct contribution or some sort of income tax, taxes on carriages, horses, special taxes on food, and private buildings and residences. Although members of the clergy, the army, and the state bureaucrats were expected to buy tickets, only public employees were affected. In the end, Calleja withdrew his plans because of popular discontent. As for the Royal Lottery, it never saw again the prosperity of previous years. In 1821, the institution finally closed its doors after more than a decade of fighting to stay afloat. Let me wrap up my argument by putting together the threads what I have been discussing. it is clear that the creation and promotion of a state-sponsored lottery was a source of wonderful contradictions in colonial Mexico, late colonial Mexico. Concerned about the libertinage, the depravity, and the disorder triggered by gambling, Bourbon reformers hoped to redirect this dark passion, this is the way they called it, a dark passion, by establishing a royal lottery. Paradoxically, by revamping gambling as a socially acceptable form of economic gain, risk-taking entertainment, the Spanish crown shifted away from the Bourbon ideals of work, frugality, and productivity. More important still is the fact that the royal lottery contributed to the impoverishment, not to the betterment of the gamblers. The lottery was created at a time of growing economic and social disparity, and it fed on the popular anxiety over job losses, price increases, and stagnant wages that characterized the late colonial period. In putting together gaming and economic gain, Bourbon reformers contributed to the gradual transformation of gambling into an impersonal and fetishistic form of consumption of money, wrapped in morally uplifting and altruistic clothes. Traditional Catholic writers have long associated money and economic gain with the deadly sin of greediness and the unquenchable pursuit of riches. The denunciation of gambling as a dishonest form of wealth acquisition also responded to the general condemnation of money. In the moralist view, lust for money and greed were at the heart of emotional excesses that made of gambling a dark passion, unquenchable, inordinate, and all-consuming. The revaluation of attitudes toward money and the acquisitiveness had to wait until the following century, when Spain adopted mercantilist practices that brought merchants to increase economic, social, and political prominence. Merchants were involved in all of the most profitable aspects of colonial economy by the 18th century, including the royal lottery, which, of course, borrowed funds from this very important merchant, Pedro de Terreros, the Count de Regla, to start operating. According to the Patricia Seed, by the middle of the 18th century, quote, secular writers argued that men might seek to make life happy and agreeable through money, and were more inclined to admit the benefits of material possessions, unquote. Undoubtedly, the establishment of state-sponsored gambling contributed to the removal of moral taboos toward the pursuit of money. More important still, it promoted the consumption of money as a legitimate source of fantasies of social and economic betterment in difficult times. The colonial officers promoted the lottery as a sort of Bourbonic eutrapelia, an honest recreation that provided rest and relaxation for the participants as they turned later on more productive pursuits. Later defined as well-turning, eutrapelia was the Aristotelian virtue of well-turning, or turning to play or other relaxing activities without losing oneself in them, with the purpose of resting before returning to serious things. These ideals of temperance and self-restraint certainly fit the enlightened rejection of the emotional excesses of the Baroque, as characterized by recent scholarship of Bourbon Mexico. Inspired by the work of Norbert Elias, scholars have argued that the Bourbon reformers embrace emotional restraint and hope to instill in their subjects the supreme virtues of moderation, discipline, and self-control. This characterization of the Bourbon cultural project is consistent with the grand narrative of unabated march towards emotional repression in the 18th century as part of what Elias used to call the civilizing process. Scholars have often characterized colonial states as institutions obsessed with the repression of unruly passions. In reality, as Anne Stoller has recently argued, colonial authorities were equally interested in harnessing them in the interests of political power, colonial governance, and the public good, in quotation marks. Colonial officers were not only expected to train their own emotions, but also to guide those of their subordinates. I would like to suggest in this sense that the creation and promotion of the Royal Lottery in colonial Mexico was predicated upon the management and not the suppression of the emotional excesses that the Bourbon so much decried. In fact, the lottery could be plausibly considered, I think, as nothing more than an emotional machine. It appealed to the sense of the consumers, it preyed on their anxieties, it profited on their desires, and they produce a new source of income by fostering an unwarranted sense of hope. Finally, in marketing the lottery as an exciting form of leisure and charity, the Bourbons contributed in practice to the gradual de-stigmatization of the gambler and the emergence of other forms of illegal gambling. Thank you. Yes, please.
I wanted to sort of touch on two things that you said about the lottery as a form of late colonial governmentality, and then your discussion at the end of Anstolar and civilization. One of the things that kept coming up for me is the issue of loyalty and colonial loyalty. And I wonder if you have found in the documents discussions of this, and if so, can we think of loyalty, given all the emotions that you're talking about, and I would argue maybe loyalty is also an emotion, can we rethink state loyalty in terms of leisure, charity, trust, and all of these other things that are at play as well? Did you come across any?
Well, the only direct evidence that I had about the connection between loyalty as an emotion and the whole context of the lottery was when these cases of fraud took place. Because in this particular case, accountability was connected to loyalty, to being loyal to the king and to the interests of the crown, defending the interests of the crown. So for that particular issue, local officers, colonial officers, didn't behave as they were expected to do. And that is the only real connection that I saw, but if the lottery itself was considered a project for the betterment of the population, it was something promoted by the king himself, perhaps in buying tickets you would also be, you know, showing some acceptance of the ideals of the king, and in that sense show some loyalty to the colonial ideals. But I don't know, I need to work. Thank you.
Thanks. Yeah.
Yes, please.
I had a question just from the beginning that was, it was puzzling to me. The way that the lottery was initially presented to the, that it was something about the more wealthy benefits for them, and then the lower classes, the crown said it would make them not poorer but happier. Right. And I was just wondering, in what sense could you take that seriously? Just looking at the map that you provided, when they set the price for the lottery at 20 pesos, which is over 2 months' wages for the average lower class person, right? So, unless they thought that everybody was going to win, which unless they had no understanding of the lottery at all, they couldn't have thought that. So, what sense could they seriously? Make that kind of claim. It's not going to make them poorer but happier. I mean, any sort of happiness that might come from the sense of excitement of, the whole pomp and circumstance and the expectation, it's hard to see, right, how that could somehow compensate for 2 months of wages. And even when it went down to 4 pesos, that's still half a month's rent, or half a month's wages, which still seems pretty significant. So I'm just a little puzzled by that initial claim that they presented.
Right. Well, of course, because most of the people lost when they were gambling, the most important issue for the crown is to show that this was a source of entertainment. So by showing something, providing them with a new source of entertainment, they will make people happier. But there's certainly some hypocrisy, some cynicism there, but they seriously thought that there was something that they could contribute to the entertainment of the population by putting together the lottery. You always find in these discussions about the normativity of the lottery, entertainment and happiness and making people feel better about themselves and their lot, in life. But,
yes. It's hard to think of.
They were serious about it.
The question of, is the crown seriously presenting it that way? And then also a question, I guess, of are the people really buying into that? Was that one of the reasons why they thought that all of this excitement really is worth it? This is going to make me That's wrong. But you're suggesting that the Crown did take the, that they meant this to be a kind of a serious claim that this would really make people happier. It's not just purely propaganda.
That's how they put it, and they invested in making sure that people would see it this way. They had these engravings, they had these rituals, they had these pomp and circumstance. They thought that this was the way to market their product. Make people happier, make them, you know, look forward to the lottery drawings, publish the results. Alejandro, I'm sorry.
Sort of following up with what's happening, you mentioned at the beginning that there was a sort of hegemonical construction, meaning that the consumer needs were taken into consideration a part of the process of building the lottery. So I don't know if you can talk a little bit more about that. So what kind of consumer expectations were built into the machine, you know, the emotional machine that you were talking about?
What I argued is that they cannot instill in people the desire to gamble. They just cannot do that. But they can give them incentives. They can tell them why gambling is a good thing, you know, because you're contributing to a better good, because it is something that in the long run is gonna help all of us. But in order to do that, they needed to reinvent lottery as something that is exciting in itself. So this is the reason I claim that they were somehow selling tickets to a real life drama. That this is the thing that lottery was actually selling. That it was selling them excitement, and only in that sense I claim that they were taking into consideration the consumers' desires. But it's a little bit halfway between manufacturing without necessarily manufacturing. And believing upon what was already there. People already gambled. They gambled at the time. So the state would try to offer something that would compete with the other forms of gambling. So that is, I don't know if I answered your question.
Well, I think you answered that question.
OK.
I really like this project. I'm wondering a little bit, though, about how you would parse the difference between skill versus luck in the way that gambling or that the lottery was understood. So one of the advantages of gambling is that a good gambler can win, and actually the experience of winning is itself. You could actually be playing for, you know, marbles. The experience of winning confirms one's skill, one's, you know, symbolic domination of the other players, whatever. Whereas in the lottery, you know, really, I think would require a suspension of disbelief, in a certain sense, to believe that there was any skill involved. That leads to my first question. Do you think that there was actually a sense that skill was involved? Because you talked about the Talmudic texts, you talked about, you know, some numerology, some sort of these sorts of things, and actually, you know, when I go into a 7-Eleven a day and I see people buying lottery tickets, it seems too complicated for me to do. There's a lot of esoteric knowledge that's actually required to correctly buy the right lottery ticket for this. But so I'm wondering if there actually is, at least symbolically, a degree of skill.
More
skill
than else, you'll think of this.
Exactly. Do you have any ideas for good numbers? And the other goes another way, and it builds off of your first project, in which there is this sense that luck is involved, and therefore people, I think that in your first project you're talking about an earlier historical moment, would make a pact with God, you know, let me win, and when they inevitably don't, they tend to blaspheme and do other bad things. And so I guess my question is really, how was that? How did people see this question of skill versus luck? And was there a religious component to it?
Well, the state itself tried to sell the idea that you could actually learn to play better the lottery. There's the reason for all this literature. They have these almanacs. I don't have copies of the almanacs, but they have a bunch of literature that is teaching people how to better how to increase their odds, how to better play the lottery. So there's some not really luck. There's no luck as a real thing. Everything is ordained by God. So you lose is because of God wanted you to lose. By the 18th century, chance becomes something important, something to be taken into consideration. And you don't find blasphemy cases anymore. Because now there's a distinct possibility you just lost because you were not lucky. I mean, God is that has nothing to do with that. So, but that implies moving from danger, ideas about danger, to ideas about risk. In risk, you talk about probabilities, you talk about odds, things that you never took into consideration in the 16th and 17th century, because everything was providentialist, seen in a providentialist manner. Please.
Thank you, it was very interesting. One of the things I got most out of your talk is this idea of by state-sponsored gambling, that it was really a mechanism of social control. Mm-hmm. And so in the beginning, for example, you talked about the fact that there were all these constructions of the gambler as, you know, with a moral debauchery, led to poverty, and so on. And in reality, excessive gambling does lead to troubles in the household, mm-hmm. where there's problems of people not being able to pay the bills, they lose their property, and so on, so on. So if the state is not only seeing that, and you know, they're constructing a notion of debauchery, right? But they're also seeing the devastation that gambling really can cause, right? And so it's almost as though I'm wondering, to what extent was there a conscious notion of the use of gambling to sort of control the population? I mean, the same way that alcohol was, for example, among indigenous populations. The Spanish community used that as a mechanism of control. Mm-hmm. So I'm wondering how much you saw that or thought about that.
Well, this was not only an issue of rhetoric. This is not only that they thought that by putting together the lottery, they would get rid of the other forms of illegal gambling. This is not something they said. They tried to do a bunch of things to make sure that this happened, such as getting rid of the competition, creating gambling dens. So in that sense, they created the lottery as some form of institution. They would try to control other ways of gambling. This is the connection I tried to make between colonial governmentality and this project of the state. That this is not. There was already a lot of literature dealing with domestic violence, dealing with excesses, with that took place in the household in the 16th and 17th century. By the 18th century, gambling is associated with other things. The idea of redefining gambling as charity and as leisure, nice leisure, was basically a way of telling them, you can still gamble, but now you're going to contribute to the idea of public good. And public good as a concept becomes something important in the 18th century. It was not so much the case in the 17th and 16th century. So,
but you don't think there are elements of intentional effort to pursue mechanisms of social control, controlling the population, or using it as a way to sort of explain away the poverty or justify the poverty?
To justify poverty? Well, this is something that you touched on in your question. That is the idea that there's really no way that people are going to overcome poverty by playing the lottery. So the only thing that the state could do was to claim that they were going to be happier. It's very difficult to claim that the lottery is a form of control in a direct way. What I'm trying to say is that you see it in the larger context of all the things that the state was doing at the same time, the lottery contributed to the idea of governmentality. But I don't know if I answer. Jeff also has it. Yeah.
I'm wondering about the larger mm-hmm. vision that the state has here of economic development mm-hmm. and the way that it wants to nurture a certain kind of economic development and draw on it in terms of building up, maintaining and bolstering the power mm-hmm. of the state. So I'm wondering about gambling and then these other moralized ways of describing economic activity, like leisure, consumption, charity, whether, on the one hand, obviously it's a way of talking about certain specific gambling practices, like playing these prohibited games, but in other broader ways, I'm thinking that it speaks to a vision of economic conditions in Mexico in the late 18th century, and how the Bourbons want to move forward for that, and as I say, and use that to bolster the colonial state. I'm wondering how this discourse around the world, trying to ride the tiger or the animal, you know, fits in something like that.
Right. I think I said at the beginning of the paper, at the end of the paper, that there was this big paradox, or this contradiction between the ideals of frugality, productivity, and morality that the Bourbons were trying to promote, and at the same time trying to destigmatize the gambler in practice. That happened over and over. But the larger project was to make sure that the people become more productive, that the state is able to collect more taxes, that more income goes into the crown. So in the larger context of increasing taxes, the lottery was another strategy of increasing taxation. That was seen as they had this pressing need of finding new sources of income. That's what happened in the second half of the 18th century, and that is the reason the lottery was also connected to this larger economic goal.
Improvement
productivity. Oh, well, that I need to discuss other things. Well, but the lottery itself is not connected to the ideal. The urban ideals were about productivity, about taxation, stuff like that. But it's only that lottery gambling doesn't contribute to productivity. But the ideal of the Bourbon reformers was to make sure that people become more productive. But I need to discuss other things that where you could see this in action. This is just the larger context of where the Bourbon reforms are operating, in which they operate. Yeah.
I'm wondering, who exactly the lottery was aimed at, which people? So, especially when you talk about consumption or consumerism, leisure, and then the images that you have,
right.
They're all these pretty well-to-do men. They're not laborers. And so who is really the kind of object of the state action that you're talking about?
Right. Well, as I said before, the lottery didn't do well until they lowered the price of the tickets. And most of the tickets were sold in urban settings in Mexico City. And it was only then that the lottery started to do well. Now, of course, they are not showing poor people here, with the exception of the other guy that I showed. In this one, these are poor people. These are poor guys. This is the reason it was so successful. Well, I don't know.
It looks sort of, well, I don't know, we can talk about it.
But right, but if I am a poor person, I don't want to be depicted there. I mean, I want to improve my lot, so I'm going to consume products that are going to make me look better or do better in life. So,
but I mean, in terms of consumption, how much did poor people participate in a consumer society, and how much were they, with what was going on? I don't actually know.
Right. Well, I have to confess here that this whole section of my paper is quite speculative. And the main reason is because I don't have the data. I don't have the data. I would like to know who bought the tickets, how much they were making, were they men or female, were there any women. I mean, all the kinds of nice questions that sociologists are able to ask. I just have these documents that talked about lottery gambling, a famous case of fraud, and then the context in which the decrees were issued. So what I tried to do is to show you how is that when things were really, really bad in 18th century Mexico, still people were able to, the lottery was able to do well, which was a paradox. I just didn't understand how this was possible until I started to think how they rethought gambling, how they revamped gambling. But as to the social profile, the particular status of the consumer, I just don't know. I mean, I'm assuming, of course, a bunch of things. You buy my argument, then. But it's only that I would like to offer you the evidence, the real evidence, but I don't have.
Thanks for this.
Mm-hmm.
Can you say more about the emotional machine? The machine is very briefly. I think you assumed that I'm more knowledgeable about the emotional machine than I may be. But so, could you tell more about?
Mm-hmm. Well, what I mean by emotional machine, and I apologize for the metaphor, is that they were producing things. Pardon me?
Is this something I'm supposed to know? Or?
Oh, no.
Can you clarify that?
No, what I meant is that the state produces things. The state is able to produce part of what Sarah Ahmed used to call the emotional economy. That is, in the circulation of emotions, emotions accrue value. So not all the emotions are the same, so that when they circulate, that they start accruing value. Excitement becomes more interesting, becomes more exciting as people talk about exciting things. So in that sense, looking at engravings, building suspense, you know, excitement becomes the defining emotion of the lottery. But that's what this is again.
But it looks like it can backfire too, right? I mean, because sure. In some sense you're saying that there was a significant element of control from the government and trying to collect more taxes. In 1810, the system stopped working. Mm-hmm. I'm assuming the emotions. I mean, so.
Right.
I'm assuming the emotions went the other way. This
way. Yeah, I try to argue that uncertainty, for example, as connected to emotions, can work both ways. It was good when you didn't know about the future because it built, it nourished suspense. But by the late 18th century, of course, the state itself is in crisis. So uncertainty about the future is not necessarily something that would contribute to trust, contribute to the, just to buying tickets, because you don't know what's going to happen. Mm-hmm. Yeah, oh, please.
Sorry I was late for you, but I read your paper carefully. Mm. I'm just wondering if the state-sponsored gambling, which is a really important intervention you make here, mm-hmm. was about anxiety about other forms of illicit mm-hmm. sort of gambling in mm-hmm. a sort of popular way. I'm a Caribbean, trained as a Caribbeanist, and you know, not in this period, but certainly in the 19th century and early 20th century, mm-hmm. when the state gets involved in lotteries, it was to control cockfighting, uh-huh. you know, other sorts of, you know, illicit sort of uh-huh. African sort of derived gambling pleasures, and mm-hmm. it was very much a way to kind of manage some of the things that you talk about here. Is there any evidence of that?
Mm-hmm. Well, the state also controlled cockfighting in Mexico. But the lottery was way more profitable than cockfighting. I have some numbers in the paper, but.
And there was no anxiety about cockfighting and or those other kinds of.
Mm-hmm. Well, because the state was making some money out of gambling. I mean, cockfighting, people needed to pay some taxes because of organizing the fights. So that is also the case of selling gambling cards. They still also had a monopoly on gambling cards. So at the same time they were saying that gambling is bad, they were making money. The same goes, you know, for all kinds of things. The lottery also increased other forms of illegal gambling because there will be other lotteries organized before the lottery took place, the lottery drawings took place. So people would buy, I don't know, 50 tickets, say somebody was rich, and then he would organize a lottery to sell those tickets. So you would buy a ticket to have a chance for a lower price in the big one.
That's what Ticketmaster doesn't let you do, right? Yeah.
Yep,
I mean, I'm wondering with this question, if there aren't different state crown practices between British and Spanish Catholicism and Protestantism in terms of what may be an anxiety for Protestants? Is it really an anxiety for Catholics? Okay? You know, I don't know. So maybe there's just maybe different sort of cultural and institutional practices.
Yeah, and the Afro-Caribbean, it was also kind of African-centered forms of savings, and there's something in Trinidad called susu, where people would collect their money and get a hand, like, you know. Mm-hmm. So it was a way to kind of regularize in the gist of what you were saying, when the state gets involved, and to sort of tap down on all of these sort of aberrant potential public endeavors that could threaten the state in, you know, any particular
country. But I'm wondering if because you could do a comparison to Cuba, right?
Yes, exactly.
Okay, that question may be answered.
In the case of Mexico, by the 18th century, there are no discussions about. You would see some discussion about Satan in the 16th century, 17th century. Satan has something to do with what's going on in the Cambrian table, but certainly not anymore in the 18th century. No, and as I try to argue, even preachers were putting together this idea of lottery day as some sort of a way of talking about judgment day, because it's exactly the same thing. You don't know the expectation, what's going to happen, God is going to pull my number or not. So, yep.
The Illinois State Lottery was almost 40 years ago in just about the same way this one was. Mm-hmm. And the social good was equality in educational funding to make sure that around the entire state, almost every student would receive just about the same amount of money. That hasn't happened. But one of the effects was to decrease the ethnic-based gambling, because the various ethnic groups like the Italians or the Jews or the Poles, they would have their own ethnic-based gambling. Mm. And this pulled away so much money that a lot of these ethnic-based gambling organizations just collapsed, because you know, they were just people were buying the state lottery tickets instead of, you know, the ethnic base. So was there anything like that that happened with the national lottery? Was there any local ethnic base, or was it just more the local lotteries were kind of driven out of business because of the national lottery was instituted?
Mm-hmm. I don't know. No, I don't know. I mean, that's a very good question, but I don't have information about this. I know that when the state started to raid gambling dens, they were targeting popular neighborhoods. So we imagine, you know, plebeian, what they call, historians call the plebeian sectors of the population, that is people of mixed race, the poorer sectors of the colonial Mexico, but I don't know. Yeah, please.
A kind of very superficial question, but when I think of lotería, you know, I realize that there's this paid lottery, and then there's the juego de lotería, which is so iconically common.
Uh-huh.
I'm imagining there's no connection whatsoever, because that's more like a bingo game.
Right.
My understanding is it's the prizes aren't as large as what would be in a lottery, but is there any connection, or is there anything interesting to notice about this kind of colonial lottery and what we understand is la lotería mexicana de hoy en día?
Mm-hmm. Well, there was a special issue in Artes de Mexico that it talked about these two forms of lottery as in a general discussion about suerte, the notion of suerte in 18th century Mexico. Perhaps in that very large sense, there's a connection between how people see the abandoning of a providential way of looking at gambling to a more chance-oriented way of understanding gambling. Mm-hmm. Suerte becomes something important, luck becomes something important in the 18th century. Before, people talked about chiripas. I found chiripas in the... A chiripa is something that... it was a little bit like by sheer luck. You made something by sheer luck. But that was that happened in the 17th century, late 17th century. By the 18th century, it's only when you have suerte. Perhaps that would be the only connection that I can think of.
So, I love this idea of recasting lottery gambling as a kind of something experiential, as a kind of spectacle. But I'm wondering to what extent, and whether you know this, does the state model its marketing of the lottery on the marketing of other popular amusements? Like, I mean, you talked about, you showed the engravings on the one hand, and you talked about the main draw being the kind of, the drawings as a kind of spectacle taking place in time, as a kind of performance that's mimicking other entertainments. So I wonder, like, what were other popular entertainments of the time, and how were they being marketed? And is there a kind of formal, you know, similarity in the recasting of gambling as a kind of, you know, a leisure activity, as entertainment, as popular amusement?
Well, there was, of course, theater. There was all those popular spectacles such as bullfighting, rituals, parades, all these things took place at the time, but none of them built upon suspense. I think the only thing that would be closer to suspense perhaps would be like the royal entries of the king, the royal parades where the king, the viceroy was presented. There was some sort of a little bit of suspense, but not much. Yes, but they used to fight bulls in a different manner. I mean, they didn't kill bulls at the time, so it was a little bit like it was a little bit different. I don't know. I guess I should know, but I don't know. But Viqueira, Pedro Viqueira, is the one who wrote in a very nice book about all forms of entertainment in the 18th century. And he talked about the importance of theater and all these kinds of games. I tried to make a connection between theater and the lottery because of the notion of suspense. When you have these farces, and you don't know what is going to happen at the end. You're also plotting the lottery, offering some sort of drama, you know, about what is going to happen. But the lotteries were also modeled after other lotteries. So the Spanish crown was also trying to copy what other people did. And that is a very interesting question. I need to see that connection to all other forms of spectacle. And how the lottery responded, mimicked, or how and something entirely different to offer in the market of excitement at the time. Yeah.
It's kind of interesting, though, before your question. So I think that there's something, individually participatory, though, in the drama here, because you can win.
Right.
I mean, you know, that really does
right.
make it. I mean, the investment here, the emotional investment. And clearly, the monetary investment too ups the ante in terms of the individual drama that you can live.
Right. I mean, that's a big difference with theater, but it's just a metaphor. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Well, great. We can continue informally at this section.
Thank you. Thank you. Oh, yes.
Also, they started in Spain before it came to Mexico.
Yes. They had a primitive form of lottery and then they copied what happened in Mexico.